Chapter 15, The Psychedelic Folk.
From initially wondering how on earth these people never managed to have a hit record, you're soon left wondering how on earth it is Johnny Moped ever managed to get around to recording a single, let alone releasing an entire album. Yet come the start of 1978, the psychedelic release cycle starts spinning and we enter what we will define, very, very cautiously, as the band's purple patch. So Johnny Moped moved on from Brenda. More specifically, he moved on to the couch of Tony Robinson. No, not Baldrick, although that would have added even more hilarity to the whole comedic package. Which happened at some point after Tony accidentally became the manager of the Mopeds. Which happened at some point during a Chiswick label showcase at Camden's Roundhouse, when Johnny Moped supported label mates Deaf School, The Doctors and Radiators from Space on February the 19th. Just about. He was the road manager, but he thought he was the band manager, recalls a vague Dave Burke. This vagueness might be down to the fact that while the rest of the Mopeds were inside the venue preparing to open the show, their frontman was nowhere to be seen. Not much changed there then, but this was an absence with a difference. Having graciously swerved late afternoon soundcheck responsibilities, it was enough just to get him to turn up for the gig, let alone turn up at 4:30 or whatever, points out Ian Damage sagely. Johnny was now standing in his own showtime. Trouble was, the ever diligent door people didn't believe that Johnny was fronting up the band, who were due on stage in not but a quarter of an hour. Roundhouse rock stars patently don't queue patiently with the punters on Chalk Farm Road. "I couldn't get in," yelps Johnny. "I had to ask for one of the dam's roadies, the professor, to come out and verify who I was. Still, every cloud and all that, Xerxes wasn't looking forward to doing the set on his own. He would have done it if needed, but he didn't want to, so he gave a right old sigh of relief when I turned up." This Roundhouse show has another special place in the pantheon of magic moped gigging moments. Word has it that after the performance, he got the band to drop him off on Purley Way, whereupon he spent the night sleeping in the bushes to avoid going home for a domestic dressing down. But as Tony Robinson's extracurricular managerial responsibilities grew, so Johnny's evenings spent fumbling around in Croydon's finest foliage were destined to become a distant, if slightly disturbing, memory. Tony was so dedicated to being band manager, he had Johnny living with him for months, Dave reveals. And that's where the track comes from on the bootleg album where Johnny's talking about his underpants disintegrating. Because he had Johnny around his flat and Johnny smelt so badly, he washed all his clothes and his underpants actually disintegrated. So that's on the bootleg album. But yeah, Tony and his wife Claire put up with a lot of it. What is most curious is that at the precise point when Johnny Moped were firing on as many cylinders as they could bravely muster, with Johnny himself a free man and a psychedelic album ready to roll, the Damned were missing. Presumed, lost in traction. Paul Marcos, the Roxy London WC2, A Punk History, gets to the heart of the matter. Fortunes had changed for the Damned, who were Roxy regulars in its early days. Dropped by Stiff Records, managerless, and with their last album and tour dogged by poor sales and attendance, Brian James left for a solo career. On the 1st of March, 78, it was announced that they were splitting up. Conversely, on the 10th of March, 78, Johnny Moped released their most potent pop moment yet in Darling, Let's Have Another Baby, which, as already discussed, may well have been banned by the BBC, but then again, as also discussed, probably wasn't at all. And a fortnight later, the psychedelic album was released on March the 24th. That same week, the Stranglers most certainly weren't struggling to get into the charts at number 2 with Black and White. Squeezing in between the original soundtrack efforts from Saturday Night Fever and The Stud, the remainder of the top 10 was slightly less frisky, although the walls of the MOR establishment remained thoroughly bolstered by long players, by the likes of Max Boyce, Johnny Mathis, ABBA, Genesis and Rita Coolidge, as well as 20 golden greats from Frank Sinatra and Nat King Cole, although not on the same album, obviously. So it was, into this feral, creative atmosphere that Psychedelic was launched. Like most debuts, the album was a springtime summary of the Mopeds' hectic story so far, a definitive collection of anything they'd ever set out to do and everything they'd ever achieved, apart from Hard Loving Man. That wasn't on there, nor was No One, but apart from Hard Loving Man and No One, Psychedelic was a comprehensively shabby, shaggy, shouty distillation of everything the Mopeds have worked for 4 years or more. And then, in the midst of the chaos, specifically in the middle of Maniac, there is the sound of an absolute lovely cosmic guitar solo from Slimy Toad. It's delightful and delightfully weird, like it's been dropped from a totally different album. Punk Floyd, indeed. Under the crashingly sympathetic headline of Is This Man a Basket Case?, Monty Smith in The Enemy mounted a serious case for the casually demented defence in his album review. Musically, Psychedelic is as unfinished and slapdash as that poncy French dish where they plonk a raw egg on top of some uncooked mince, and stylistically, it's all over the shop, ranging from the goonish anarchism of Mystery Track, VD Boiler, through the punky and western of Darling, to straight-ahead rock and roll, the climatic trilogy of hooligan rock, Wild Breed, Hellraiser and Incendiary Device. Vocally, Moped carries all the aces. His rantings are wantonly amateurish, endearingly so. His manic diction possessing the scabrious quality of a pesky streetwise wide boy, a tart cross between Joe Strummer and Ian Dury. An eccentric, to be sure, and maybe even a bit soft in the head. Over at Sounds, meanwhile, Jane Suck was letting rip. I used to hate Johnny Moped. Whilst all around me, in their all-too-sporadic gigs, were falling about with laughter, dancing the dork and praising Moped's vocalese and charismatic personalities, exuding from the pores in his tattooed arms and declaring Slimy Toad a guitar hero. I stood a minute, blinking in the light of my ignorance. Then I heard an acetate of the album and saw God, the resurrection and myself impaled on a corkscrew. Well, leastways, I thought it was great and my, unbelievably funny. The review goes on to compare Johnny Moped with the Damned, the Monkees, and also much maligned and misunderstood band, as well as a modern-day Van Morrison. It then praises the excellent production job before hurtling towards this heartily concussed conclusion, a concept album of boozed, blind chaos. Tell all your friends Johnny Moped is a star. Someone tell him too, please. Another great irony. There are so many great ironies in the Johnny Moped story. They could open their own bleeding Morphy Richards warehouse. Is that wayward kidnapped singers accepted? The way Roger Armstrong describes the whole psychedelic creative process was anything but slapdash or amateurish. In fact, hobnobbing with the Chiswick man behind the McVitie's Biscuit Emporium in Harlesden, he uses the phrase painstaking, while reminiscing happily about the recording and the mixing process, relishing the memory of turning the tapes upside down to get the swirly effects in his own favourite song, the dark, trippy 3D Time. Did Chiswick get the record they wanted, or indeed expected? We got the record we got. It's all right. It sounds a bit thin to me these days, but that was just the punk sound back then. It certainly rips along. I was so into the sound effects, like the toilets at the end of Wee Wee and the segueing of tracks together. Psychedelic is such a weird record. It doesn't sound like anything else overall. I remember sitting in the studio thinking, God, these guys are really good. We did a certain amount of overdubbing and beefing up, but essentially it was a simple record. I added Johnny's vocals later, especially for Darling, kicking and screaming because he didn't want to do it. In a way, the Mopeds were too complicated to be influential, Roger chuckles. It's not like the Pistols playing one gig in Manchester and then everybody in the audience forms a group or anything like that. You could see how you could see the Pistols and go home and learn to play them. You couldn't do that with the Mopeds. You couldn't go home with Psychedelic and learn how to play it. It's too complicated. Moped is Moped. He really is that unique. In the Basically film, a proud Captain Sensible insists, I knew there was a genius album in that guy and Psychedelic proves me right. Really, because it's just the most sensational record. When we meet him face to face, he's even more weepy about the album, saying it was beautifully recorded. The reverb on the vocal was very nice. If these are scarcely believable utterances from a man who, when not rolling around on broken bottles of Newcastle Brown Ale with Sid Vicious, was genuinely nurturing a reputation as a reckless punk rock clown, then matters get stranger still when his role as a moped comforter extraordinaire comes to light. The captain was great making the record, says Roger. A whole other side of him came out. He'd turn up at the studio and he was totally paternal to Johnny. The transformation was remarkable. The captain always had this gentle side to him. There was a really nice guy in there. Sometimes acting in spite of himself, he was verging on the paternal with Johnny. He was great when he was around him and Johnny responded to him, you know? There was no rivalry between the Damned and the Mopeds. I remember Dave inviting Johnny up at a Damned show to do New Rose and he ripped it up. Yeah, I'd be vibing Johnny up in the pub, the captain confirms. I just want to see him to fulfil his potential. I thought he really had something. When we first started, I remember my dad. He'd come back from shift work at midnight and we'd be still jamming away. And he'd say, come on, knock it off. And one day he said, I'm not sure about the rest of you, but Johnny's really got something. Even he could see it. And he liked crooners like Elvis. He never liked us, but he liked Johnny. Not satisfied with signing the band, producing their album and spending several spare hours pleading with the frontman to actually front up and deliver some vocal takes, Roger's creative remit stretched to packaging the entire Johnny Moped model. Chiswick and their Skinny Tide label cousin, Stiff, had both been early adopters of 7-inch picture bags as part of the general pub punk promotional programme. To this end, Roger brought in Artistic Type and Serious Outsider, Barney Bubbles. Part of the psychedelic counterculture in the 60s, he'd hovered at the far extremes of cosmic reality at UFO. Barney's work embraced an enveloped artwork and sleeves for Hawkwind, Elvis Costello and Ian Dury and the Blockheads, as well as the psychedelic campaign concepts. In John Savage's England's Dreaming, Barney is described as a shy obsessive who'd been a key part of the Hawkwind Live family, divorced as they were from the music industry with their dancers and their lights and their silver machines. When you went to see them, you entered this whole experience, even without the drugs. His experience quickly led him away from a surreal mundaneness to an inspired pastiche, expanded Savage, performed with a wit sadly lacking by the time the process became industrialized in the mid-1980s. His cover for the Damned's Music for Pleasure, borrowed from Kandinsky's 1924 Yellow Accompaniment, while his design for Your Generation by Generation X was pure Rodchenko. He took design to a level of high art, Roger nods approvingly. In basically, he came up with a moped light bulb image. Barney was not a man necessarily given to explaining his work, but it's interesting the way it's used on the album. Not satisfied with the arty artwork, Johnny Moped and Barney Bubbles proceeded to make arty promo videos for the singles, notably dressing up as ladies in true Pythoness fashion during Darling, Let's Have Another Baby, and even more notably, hanging with a very much non-dressed young lady in Incendiary Device. It was a great collision between, you know, this kind of art world person and these guys that came from Croydon. With his very eccentric and very strange take on the world, in a way, it was a lovely match, enthuses Roger. I know he put an awful lot of effort in because he really loved Moped.